Hey everybody, and welcome to a revealing wild ride with Steve-O. Not only are we going to learn some crazy stuff about a legend of hip-hop, which Too Short is, we're also going to perhaps reveal me to be getting pretty good at interviewing people. I think I did a good job on this one, man. But let me tell you what does a great job. The Tushy Ace from HelloTushy.com. I'm telling you, man, I've always said this is my favorite sponsor of the Wild Ride podcast, and that is not changing, man. This new product comes with a remote that just sticks to my wall. When I get ready to take a dump, boom, I hit seat temperature, so that just warms up the seat, so I'm nice and comfy. I take my dump, and then when I get done, boom, I blast the bum blaster. Oh my gosh. It's just the most luxurious bidet that you could possibly get. And it's got a front blaster for the ladies too. So when I get done blasting my butt, then I hit dry. Boom. And a little butt dryer comes out. It's so comfy. It's so luxurious. The holidays are coming up and you cannot get a more luxurious gift for the person that you love. Yeah. So go to HelloTushy.com/Steve-O to get 10% off your order and be among the very first people to ever try the Tushy Ace. Man, it is so awesome. One more time, HelloTushy.com/Steve-O for 10% off your order and so that you can be one of the very first people to get a chance to try the Tushy Ace. Now let's get into it. Ladies and gentlemen, Too Short. Yeah, dude.
What's up, dude?
What's up, what's up?
This is my co-host, Scott Randolph.
What's going on?
And up at the front, we have the gorgeous Paul Brisky.
Nice to meet you, man. How are you?
Chilling, bro. I gotta tell on myself, man. I'm fucking later than shit, dude.
How late are you?
I get so, dude, it's so uncomfortable for me to be going somewhere where I'm late, and it's just like all over my body. I'm just physically just uncomfortable. I was filming a surf show for Kook of the Day. And I did catch 5 waves, but we were supposed to start 50 minutes ago. This is an awful embarrassment. It's so unprofessional of me, and I'm so sorry
well,
that we did
dope
that.
Dope whip. It's all good, man. I'm kind
of... So you're the kook of the day.
Yeah. I am the kook
you're,
of the day,
you're
dude.
Too late.
I'm on a carefree day today, so it's cool. It's
dude,
cool.
Epic,
yeah,
man.
That's good.
Thank you.
Good.
So yeah, dude, I mean, where to begin, dude? Like, you got a career that's gone for fucking ever.
Yeah, I don't know where you begin. You just kind of exist. You just there is no beginning. There is no ending.
I was checking it out, dude. Like, is it your career really began in earnest in 1983?
Around that time, I first started rapping in the year 1980. I first heard rap in 79.
Yeah.
So a year later, I'm like, I can do this, and it was just a little high school hobby. And right near the end of high school, it started, like, really growing.
At that time, like, when did, like, the Fat Boys come out?
That was same time, 82, 83, same time,
right.
Run DMC.
Mm-hmm. Run DMC was, were they even that early?
They were there. You know, Crush Groove, the movie, was a big deal. That was, like, 1984.
Right.
You know, at that time, Curtis Blow was the big guy in the movie, and Run DMC was, you know, the next upcoming stars, and LL Cool J emerged as...
But that's still way later.
LL yeah, but Cole you J. know what? But he appeared in that movie.
Okay.
He was like a new guy kicked in the door at his radio. But during that time, all this is taking place, I'm famous in the Bay Area.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not making records, I'm not signed to a label, but I'm famous. I'm doing parties, I'm making money, I'm in high school, and I'm just like, you know... Wow. I'm not really getting the opportunity of being on a major label, which I'm glad I wasn't, because I had a lot of time to be mediocre and learn, you know?
Sure.
By the time I got to a major label, I was a seasoned veteran.
What was the label? Your first label was called 75?
75 Girls Records. That was a local label, and the guy who owned it, his name was Dean Hodges. And he had, somewhere along in life, he got the formula of how to be an independent label.
So 75 Girls is a pimping reference, I would imagine.
It is a reference that he got from a Johnny Guitar Watson song. I don't know the name of the song. I know we used to listen to it. And Dean Hodges really loved this one line in the song. Johnny Guitar Watson sings, Like he was on a horse or a motorcycle or something. I can't remember. It's a long time ago. But he rides up, and all in one motion, he kisses 75 girls at the same time. And Dean liked that so much, he named his label 75 Girls Records.
Nice. That's pretty good. Man. Wow. That's an independent label.
Yeah.
Now, you recorded 3 albums on that label?
They released 3 albums. I recorded 2. The third one, the third album was a homemade tape that I used to just sit around making these little homemade tapes with a mixer and a turntable and turn some records over the instrumental side and just record songs that I wrote. And they found after I did the 2 albums and, you know, we moved on. It was like a family environment.
Sure.
The next venture that we did, I did it with Dean Hodges' little brother and his first cousin. You know, it was just...
Dangerous
Music.
Yeah.
So we're just off to the next, and it was still in the family, but you know, I mean, man, you know, I could tell you things about those years, like things.
Sure. So the albums that you put out with 75 Girls, are those the tapes that you're selling in the park?
So two of them were literally in the studio. Working in a really nice studio. The one is titled Don't Stop Rapping.
Sure.
Recorded at a studio.
That was the very first one.
Yeah, it was recorded at a studio in San Francisco, Different Fur. And the next one after that was called Players. Same thing, we went in the studio. And, you know, I'm working with professional engineers and professional musicians, and I'm learning. I'm really learning how to do all these things that are going to come in play later on. And then the third one, like I said, they found a little homemade tape I had made, and they manufactured it later on after I got signed to Jive.
Oh, damn.
They're like, okay, we got a little secret weapon. But, you know, I never had a problem with 75 Girls because, for one, we never had an agreement. We never had a written agreement. Two, Dean Hodges taught me detail how to run an independent label, every step from A to Z. And then third, you know, he taught me how to be a player. So not only was I, you know, working with these professional musicians in a professional studio, you know, we had endless weed. It was like fucking like cocaine was free. Everything was just free. Just make music and be in the environment. And I learned a lot. So
right.
I never had any problem with 75 Girls because when I look back, it was like earning a master's degree.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
And being a fucking player and a rapper and whatever.
What I think is really interesting too is that, you know, coming out of LA, there was like the hip hop was like heavily influenced by gang culture. Mm-hmm. But they didn't really have gang culture in Oakland so much as just hustlers and pimps. Let me tell you something that every single hustler and every single pimp knows. That is that you have to smell good, man. And I like to feel good about smelling good, and that's why I use Native deodorant. Because they don't test on animals, it's totally vegan, they only use ingredients that you've heard of, man. That you know are good for you. And it works so well, man. I love to use it. Plus, guess what? They've got special holiday scents just for the holidays. Candy cane, sugar cookie, fresh mistletoe. I'm telling you, there's a scent for everybody with this company, and I love them. Plus, if you go to nativedeodorant.com and use the promo code Stevo, you get 20% off your first order. And like I said, man, this company, they're good people. They do the right thing. They don't harm animals. They only use quality ingredients that are good for you. There's no aluminum. I just love them, and I want you to support them. I want you to smell good and feel good. So one more time, go to nativedeodorant.com and use the promo code Stevo for 20% off your order and to feel good about smelling good and supporting good people. Yeah, dude. Now let's talk about hustlers and pimps.
And even the gangs that are in the Bay, they don't gangbang because of blue and red and territory and this and that. Some of it could be neighborhood, others could be we're bound together by money and the hustle or like-minded things, but it's not open and shut rules of you're blue, I'm red, we're enemies. It was never like that.
There's a different kind of gangbang up there.
Is this different? Is this
gang bang?
It's if you had to analyze it and you were like law enforcement, you go, it's no different. But in the streets, it's a lot. It's different than walking around going, oh my God, let's get the dude in red. You know, it's a lot different. It's a lot different.
Yeah. And so, like, you were basically like the first mixtape cat, right? Like,
there was no name for it.
Yeah, there's no name for it. And you had just audio cassettes. And what was the first time that you went out to sell them? You sold them like to a drug dealer?
The very first tape we ever sold, I had a rap partner. His name was Freddie B. He was rapping in his world. You know, he had been to like, you know, juvenile correctional facilities and getting in trouble and stuff. And he knew lots of people all over the city from, you know, he grew up in West Oakland, lived in East Oakland. He just knew a lot of people. And I was really popular from like 1981, 82, like from being around the city, riding on the buses and having my big radio and letting people hear my raps. What do we got here? With some burritos, man. So, I'm super popular, right? But now I got these guys coming like, yeah, man, you know, my boy Freddie B, he raps, he's better than you, he's blah, blah, you know. So what they were really doing was, in the spirit of hip-hop, early 80s, they're like, let's get a battle rap going with the only two rappers we know. So they pit us to rap against each other, and we did. And as I hear a lot of rappers who became really good friends say, they first battled, and they became friends. We became friends.
Mm. Okay.
So we recorded some stuff at his house, and it was cool. And I was like, dude, you should come by my house, because I had like this quality equipment where you could record and you'd sound really good, because I knew how to set the levels and I had the right microphones and little effects machines. And when he heard what we sounded like after recording in my house, he said, we should sell this, or we could sell this, something like that. And I'm like, sell it to who? He's like, shit, some drug dealers right down the street.
Right.
Like, fuck, let's go. So
that was the first tape you sold, was to the drug dealer.
We just walked up to him and popped it in. One guy had a car with a nice little sound system. And we said, hey, you guys want to buy a rap tape? And they were like, what the fuck for? Like, why? And you know, Freddie B's like, just listen to it. So they listened. And we're just sitting there kicking it, listening. One tape. And a guy walks up to the radio. He leans in the car and presses eject and says, I'll buy it. So when he said that, like, how much? $5. Somebody else said, let me get one. We're like, well, we only got one, but we'll be back tomorrow.
Dude, that's wow. Epic. And then, and so check this out. I don't know if you guys know this, but Too Short's selling, like, a tape, before it was called a mixtape, for $5. But then, and he's selling them to drug dealers. So, like, people who are, like, kind of, like, bosses and players and hustlers, like, you know, people with influence.
The money guys.
Yeah, money people in Oakland, they start making like requests. Hey, man, you're selling these tapes. I want you to custom make me a tape where you shout me up, like work me into a rap song. So he starts custom making rap songs for like bosses in Oakland,
wow.
And he's selling those tapes for $20.
Exactly. It's like the original Cameo almost.
Dude, it's epic.
That was an accident too. That wasn't on purpose. We kind of were trying to. Went over this one guy. We were working with one of his drug dealer workers, one of his lower level guys, and he was bringing us over there because he had some really good equipment. And he wanted to be a rapper, and he's like bringing us to his spot. But at his spot, there's this fucking drugs being sold.
Yeah.
And one of the big boss guy, the actual big boss guy, is walking around with this mean face and, you know, just not saying anything to us. So we, you know, this kind of guy, you like, hey, what's up? And he just don't say shit back to you. That kind of shit. So we asked him one day, we like, hey, you want one of our tapes? We're going to just give it to him for free. And he just like lit into us with a, he's like, I don't give a fuck about rap music. Fuck that rap shit. I'm like, why would I? He's like, why would I listen to rap if it's about somebody else? If it was about me, I'd listen to it. Like,
okay.
So we like, shit, like we got cussed the fuck out by the boss, man, like some scary shit. We like, we leave and go, man, we got to make a tape about him. Like,
yeah.
Like it's mandatory. So we bring him back the tape and we just go here and walk away. Just here. Just give it to him. Just don't ask nothing ever. Yeah.
It's absolutely fucking genius because that gets you in with the most influential people.
So look at this. He never says thank you. He never says I liked it. He never said I listened to it. He never says shit. And this other guy comes walking up to us out the blue one day. We're on the streets, walking down the street. And this guy's like, like yelling. He's like, do you know where the fuck you at? And do you know who the fuck I am? He's like, if you motherfuckers don't get me a tape like you made him, I bet not ever see you out here ever again.
How day dare later, you make a
day
tape?
Day later, we're like, here you go. He was the one who, when we handed him the tape, he just gave us $20. Like, here.
Okay.
And he's like, y'all cool. So then people, that's two people that had custom made tapes. Now the requests started coming in, which is why we named them the special requests, because we started getting like summons. Like,
so when you make a special request, yeah. Are you like writing an entire song from scratch? Or are you just re-recording?
Freestyling.
So I end up with this little pad, like, you know, this size, little pocket pad. I got a pen on me or something, and I'm like taking notes. The guys on 84th want 5 tapes, like, you know. And just keep it like where we can come back and get the money. And so somebody will pull up on us. We're like sitting on the bus stop. And then like a little nice little car pull up. And they go, hey, you guys Too Short Freddie B? We're like, yeah. Like, get in the car. Like, okay. And we go drive to some little exclusive neighborhood where you can't get past the goons unless they let you pass. And then we go back and we meet the boss. He's like, yeah, I want to get one of those tapes.
Oh, shit, dude.
We're like, okay, what you want your tape to say? He's like, yeah, talk about my car and my block and, you know, name a couple of my homies. And I'm taking notes. I'm like,
oh my God, it's amazing.
All this is going in the tape. And we come back and it turned into a really popular thing that, like, just the only the bosses wanted to spend the $20 I could.
Spend the $20. It's so fucking funny, and I've never heard of that.
None of the little guys really wanted it. That's like right. Back
boss
then,
shit, dude.
But this is in the '80s, right? I mean, $20
early,
isn't
early 80s,
is a little
80,
more.
82, 83.
Yeah. Right.
How many bosses did you make it for?
The whole city. Everybody wanted one.
And everybody got their own legit original track.
People were riding around listening to a song about themselves.
That's so sick. Dude.
Wow. Dad, I mean, I've never heard of that. Like, you've got to be the only guy who came up that way. And then presumably because these people are big bosses, then now, like, when they've got you doing live gigs. And
so we also DJ'd the hood parties. Parties that, you know, it'd be like in somebody's living room, you know, just whatever, like in a fucking apartment, little tiny ass apartment crammed with people, whatever it may be. And at those parties, we did a lot of personal stuff too. Like, we'd really be naming people in the crowd. So, you know, we kind of like, it was what they were doing in New York and the Bronx. We like, let's do our version of it. So you walk in the party, you somebody, you get your name said, you know, we might put you in like some rhyming words or something. And everybody just loved us.
So who's putting on these parties?
We were on this, I guess, like house party circuit where I guess you could relate them to like what people might call like a rent party in the projects where, you know, one family's trying to raise some money in a night just to, you know. So it could just be some kids or some young people trying to make some money. So it's a really low investment. You buy a few bottles of liquor. You pass out some little index cards with invites and shit. You only need a few hundred people. And basically, the formula was you pass out these little flyers and go, come to house party on 92nd Avenue. Here's the address. It's from 11 p.m. to 3 a.m. and it's $1 to get in the door and $1 for a drink. Something like that.
All right.
And it's affordable for the party going person. They pay me about $100, $50, whatever, $75. And we DJ your party. We rap at the shit. And I found out all these things that I was doing were forms of marketing that you would want your young artists to do. So the first time they ever asked me to stand in front of a crowd of thousands of people, a friend of mine, Lionel B, he worked for Bill Graham. You know, Bill Graham did all the big concerts, the Grateful Dead, all this stuff.
Yeah, legendary promoter, yeah.
Sure.
So Bill Graham had a side company called Barrier Productions that he did a lot of urban concerts with. So they asked me if I wanted to be the opening act on one of the shows. It was when that song, it was UTFO, Roxanne.
Okay.
That old shit, 1985. And they asked me to open a show. I never had made a record, never been in the studio, just tapes only. And I went out there in front of 5,000, 6,000 people, and everybody in the crowd knew every word, everything I was saying.
Yeah, that's
I get off stage. I didn't even know it was going to happen. I get off stage and come back, and people were like, who the fuck are you? Like,
right.
How the fuck do they know your shit? You never made a record. I'm like, I don't know, man.
And then there's another, like, people like pretty notable thing is that rap music in the early 80s was just so clean. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I what comes to mind for me is the song White Lines, where it's just like a say no to drugs, like, kind of thing. You know, the Fat Boys, Run DMC, like, they didn't have, like, gangster
explicit
rap.
Lyrics.
Right, explicit lyrics. And then here you come along.
1982.
Fuck
that bitch. Shit.
Yeah.
Straight up.
And you just were unapologetic about just being, like, so you really were, like, the first, like, hardcore, like, explicit rapper talking about bitches and
yeah,
and
when you get, like, a, you know, the late 80s and you got groups like NWA emerging, I'm right there with them, but I had a head start on the genre already. Like,
sure.
When Ice-T made Six in the Morning, I mean, that was like the floodgates opening to you know, graphic rhyming, rhymes that come from the West Coast, and, you know, with a West, you know, it's graphic, like the message.
What's the Six in the Morning from Ice-T? Was that something he did on his own?
That was his rendition of Schoolie D's old Parkside Killers, whatever it was, and it's just a tale of like a day in a gangbanger's life.
Right. No, I asked that because I'm just wondering if that's like, you know, after he left NWA.
No, Ice-T, not Ice Cube.
Oh, Ice-T. Not Ice Cube.
This is before Ice-T.
Oh, shit.
Ice-T makes this movie. He shows up in the movie Breaking.
Yeah, you're right.
And he's making records before us. Like, Dr. Dre was in it kind of early as a World Class Record Crew, but I was on the explicit shit. When they were all doing that, Egyptian Lover is, you know, being...
Sure.
He's doing these hyper-sex songs, but they're not really explicit lyrics. They're just explicit content.
Uh-huh.
But I'm in Oakland, and I'm like, bitch, suck my dick. Like, literally.
Right.
And when they finally got me on the stage, which I come at the same time as Eric B and Rakim and Public Enemy, you know, the 87, 88, 89, but I'm already like seasoned. I've already been in front of hundreds of crowds. I've done so many house parties with the most ruthless gangsters that, like, basically you better be good or you might get beat up type shit. So
you go from 75 girls, and then you got your own thing is Dangerous.
Because Dangerous Music is just a carbon copy of what 75 Girls is
doing. Except it's your shit.
Except we own it now.
Right.
We don't just work for the big brother.
And how long does the Dangerous thing go?
It gets us all the way to Jive Records. And everybody who started Dangerous Music with me, I think it was around, we started it in like 87.
Okay.
So 75 Girls is like 85, 86, 87. Somewhere in the middle of 87, we switch over and we go down and we start our own company and we call it Dangerous Music and we put out Freaky Tales and we get the money now.
Right. Like, and then now, like 1989, now you're doing straight fucking...
It's a big deal. Everything's big.
Arena tour with NWA.
Yeah, all that shit.
An arena tour with NWA is a very big deal. You know, I made a very big deal out of something recently, which was to try to set a world record for doing the highest belly flop ever done into pure pee. You know what happened when we collected over 190 gallons of pure pee? It just turned out that pee was way too dark. You know why? Because I was dehydrated, man. Turns out, like, 2 out of 3 Americans experience dehydration on a regular basis. Some crazy statistics, man, and I'm one of them. So I've been taking hydration super seriously, and I finally found the ticket, man. It's called Liquid IV. And this stuff is absolutely delicious, has less sugar than one apple, and by pouring one of your little stick packets into 16 ounces of water and pounding it, you get way more hydrated than if you had just drank that water alone. These people are on top of the science, man. And honestly, I just like it because it's so darn delicious. But I'm also very concerned about staying hydrated. So it's one-stop shopping with Liquid IV. And speaking of shopping, if you go to liquidiv.com and use the promo code STEVO, they're giving 25% off the orders. People from the Wild Ride podcast. Man, I love this company. I love this product. And I love taking care of myself and being a healthy guy. So join me, okay? Get on over to liquidiv.com. Use the promo code Stevo to enjoy 25% off your order. Plus, wait until you get a load of all the flavors. Passion fruit, lemon lime, like guava. I'm telling you. Stay hydrated with me. And let's talk about NWA arena tours. So, and that was in arenas?
That's the first time I went out. It was the Straight Outta Compton tour. First time I...
Straight Outta, so you're the opening act for NWA.
I was the guy. Eazy-E called me. He's the leader of NWA. Sure. He called me and said, hey, you want to go on tour? I'm like, hell yeah. And I was the act that went on right before NWA.
Sure. So
it was a lot of opening acts.
Oh, got you. Okay.
We merged tours with LL Cool J.
You're the co-main event.
We merged tours with LL Cool J for about 2 weeks. So they were like co-headlining, and
that's not a match.
And that tour came along with like Salt and Pepper and De La Soul, right, and Kid and Play, and you know, these guys, everybody's got hot records. But if I get you like somewhere deep down south or somewhere in some little town in Michigan somewhere, you ain't fucking with me. And I ain't gonna lie, I was out there murdering groups, like murdering. Like I dare you to come on stage after me, because if even to this day, if you come on after me, you have to be of that cloth of the crowd loves me. They love my music. I'm good. Like I know a lot of groups that can go on before and after me, and we give them like the 1, 2, 3, and the crowd's having the best night of their life. But if you dare, like, don't do what I do to a crowd, and you come on after me, it really shows what you can't do. Like, if you go on before me, they love you. I come on, it turns up. And they don't notice it. But if you come on after me, you better be one of those guys. That really,
yeah.
So NWA did pretty good after you?
Oh, of course. They had all the fucking, you know, crowd participation. Yeah. They had all the drama in the show. They brought the stage set.
They had the fucking crazy explicit shit.
You know, they could go from like, they used to come on like a Ren and Dre would do a little, get everybody hyped and do a couple songs. Then Ice Cube would come out and do a... about 10, 15 minutes by yourself. And then they build up to this whole thing where you finally get to see Eazy and they all say all these fucking songs. It was amazing. Like,
oh, wow.
Fun after parties.
They did a pretty good rendition of what that show was like in the movie, Straight Outta Compton.
Oh, cool, man.
It was a lot of us who were watching the movie, like, you know, people who are
it's
close.
It's tough.
People who are close to stories, they go, that ain't how it happened.
Right, but, right. You know, it's tough to get
like,
right.
I was standing there that day. I know what really happened. So it was that type of situation.
And I heard that when you were on tour with NWA in 1989, that they had, like, protests outside the arena, that actually succeeded in shutting shows down.
Yeah, it was a lot of threats. If you sing those explicit songs, you're going to jail. It was, I remember one show, I don't even want to say where we were, but we were somewhere, it could be like Northwest, somewhere, and it was so serious, the show was sold out, and it was so serious with the parents.
Yeah.
The parents were protesting, and it was one of those towns where you can't go against your parents, you can't. And literally the tickets were sold out and the crowd was empty because on the day of the show, the community protested the venue. They came out and picketed the venue and the kids couldn't cross the picket lines with their own family.
So the show was actually canceled.
No, it wasn't canceled. We performed to an empty crowd.
Oh, really? Damn.
To a light crowd.
So you got all the money.
Got all the money.
Yeah, got all the money. Wow.
I remember doing shows back then like Tulsa, Oklahoma, and the crowd being given strict instructions that no one stands up, no one, like, you can't, like, get all into the show.
Like,
the
most you could do is,
when the song ends, you could clap. So,
wow.
It was very strange, but, you know, for the most part, we were out there wilding out. It was...
Damn. Did you ever have, like, any sort of a legal case for, like, a free speech thing, or did anything like that ever come up?
I've ran from the cops a couple times after a show.
Wow.
I've been arrested a couple times. Like, Columbus, Georgia arrested everybody. They arrested me there.
What was it? Like Two Live Crew, the felony obscenity?
Yeah, you just, you know.
I caught that charge. I beat it, too.
Yeah, they tell you, I mean, it's just a little fine or whatever. You can fight, whatever. But they tell you before you go on, they post it on the dressing room, they tell you, you cannot say these words. You can't do this. It's illegal in this city to say these words in front of a crowd.
Yeah.
And then as soon as you say, they always let me do the whole show. And you get arrested right on the side of the stage.
I did. Like, it's American heroes who have caught that obscenity charge. You got Jim Morrison, Two Live Crew, Lenny Bruce.
Prince,
Too Short.
LL Cool J.
Steve-O. Yeah. And, dude, I respect the coming up on selling the cassette tapes, man, because, I came up way later. But still, I came up at a time where for me to make my noise and get my recognition, like I had to record video cassettes. Mm-hmm. You know, I hit play on one VCR and record on the other, and I'm duplicating my tapes. I'm taking them to the post office. And so, yeah, I was kind of in the mixtape game too, man.
Exactly. I mean, you have to adapt to your environment to become popular. Like, you're really good at what you do because you do it a lot. The old 10,000 hour theory to become an expert at something. But you know you're really good. But, you know, we know people who are better than us who never make it as far as we do.
Sure. Because
they were missing that drive of the hustle, the self-marketing and stuff like that.
Right. I've been thinking about this a lot lately. And what I've arrived at is that to become successful, it's helpful to be intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
It's not mandatory. It's helpful to have discipline. But nothing is more important than enthusiasm. Enthusiasm is the driver of all things that fucking matter. You know, when people ask me, how do I do this? I want to get into this. Like, they give me advice and I say the same thing. I don't give a fuck what it is you want to do. The only thing that matters is how bad you want to do it. And it's like when you've got your mind made up and you're enthusiastic and you're just fucking driven, that's when shit happens, dude.
Yeah, I remember I was truly in love with a woman who I thought was the most beautiful woman on the planet. I was in love. And one day she said with the most serious face, this was probably, I have like 20 plus albums. This was probably when I was on like album number 4 or 5. And she's like, well, you know, now that we're in love and we're together, you know you can't sing those explicit songs anymore. And I was like, we had to break up. We had to break up because of my love for what I did. Mm-hmm. And I think back on that when you think back and go, damn, what if I'd stopped the Too Short style at album number 4?
Yeah, dude.
What would my life have been if I turned the corner?
If you got pussy whipped.
That's rule number one. How to be a player, right?
that's like, you know, some 99 problem shit, dude.
When you're in this business, I mean, things like that, like, you got to go just shy of pussy whipping. Like, you right when you notice the whipping, you got to run.
That whip comes out, dude, and I'm
got to run.
I'm,
I mean, where should
it comes to, like, you can't hang around your friends anymore. Like, the things that are making you that she got you for.
Right.
She said King J shit no more.
So when you're Eazy-E reaches out to you and brings you on tour, and that's just fucking, that's massive, man. I mean, right, that's where, like, it's no longer an Oakland thing.
Yeah, that's where I'm, like, selling 300,000 records, and I go on tour, and the tour ends, and I'm at 800,000. And then, you know, shortly after that, it goes to 1.3 million. It's like selling 500,000 in chunks just because of that hype of what we did, you know?
Right.
Your parents were both accountants, right?
My parents were college graduate accountants, and they wanted nothing to do with their child being a rapper. And like you said, it takes a certain amount of intelligence. It helps.
Yeah.
And it really does. It's like, you know, your parents say shit like, you're not wasting that brain. Like, I'm not. I just adjusted it to do this other new thing that you don't really know about yet. You'll catch on.
But how much did their career, like, stick in your head about, like, money consciousness when the money started rolling in? Were you good at it, like, keeping track, or were you just like,
I had the smarts to never let anyone else be in charge of the business or the money. So I was like, you could be my partner, and we could look at these things together, but you can't be the one who looks at the numbers and brings it in and then tell me what my
career.
Nobody could ever be that. And I saw a lot of my peers have that person in their life, and that was their downfall.
But you were like looking at the reports and like you were good at that
fucking
shit.
Thing. It, everything had to go through. My name had to be on everything. Hmm. Like you could work for me, but I couldn't work for you.
And you know, there's times where you're switching camps, and then once you switch the camp, the old camp, they got some kind of problem. They feel like all the money you're making now is their money. So even if you're in charge and you're looking at all the numbers, yeah.
I was smart enough at a young age though to like, at the end of those
partnerships,
just like I buy everybody out.
Yeah.
I'm like, how much you want to go away? Here you go. And instead of the fight for life, so when you buy them out, we can still be friends, you know?
So you went the Snoop route instead of the Dre route.
Well, Dre did something that I don't think anybody would do. He just walked away.
He walked away. And he didn't take anything with him. He started over from scratch.
He literally, legally, was like, 25% owner of what he walked away from.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And it was worth $400 million.
Right. And how many of those hundreds of millions were just disappeared with everybody in jail or dead?
It appears to be like some kind of bad money or something. Like it was.
It's crazy how much money just fucking
went. It's crazy how
poof.
Many people ran away from it.
Yeah,
and then walked away, away, then just go like they just left.
Yeah, walked away, but then Master P bought Snoop's. It's his
Snoop,
exit.
When you talk to him, he says that that exit from Death Row and that time he had on No Limit with Master P saved his life.
Absolutely.
Like he didn't have a way out. He didn't really have the business sense to get out.
Sure.
Master P showed him, this is what you're worth, this is what you can do. And
Master P brought him to Atlanta, right? Like, and
Master P, I feel like he was doing a lot out of New Orleans. And
yeah, I think it was Louisiana.
Okay.
Yeah. And,
all right.
And I think Snoop says he went and got a house in New Orleans or Houston or
somewhere.
Right.
I think it was Louisiana.
Somewhere down there. And he just kind of got him out of his element.
He bought out the contract.
And a lot of what Snoop and the Dog Pound were doing when they became Death Row artists was what things they picked up on their journey down south through Master P. Let me get it right. They were down south before Death Row. And then they did their Death Row thing and went back down south.
Oh, shit. Okay.
They were down south in Houston and messing around, you know, before they signed the Death Row.
Right. That makes sense.
Yeah. Let me get it right.
Yeah.
I remember.
That was just so, I mean, it's still the same idea. You know, you're gonna like end a partnership, you buy them out. And when you do that, is it like you got lawyers like with contracts to make it like airtight, or is it just like, hey man, be cool, here's some money?
It's a little bit of both.
Okay, yeah.
You gotta have some kind of man to man, and then you gotta have some kind of legal contract to dissolve it, but
yeah. Like, and then I guess some people don't really give too much of a fuck, you know?
I just try to avoid the fallout that turns into a war.
Right.
Because, you know, that's a waste of time, man. So it's a waste of time. And then looking back, I saw a lot of careers end through those little inner circle feuds.
100%,
and even, like,
man.
You just pick a few people over at the, signed to a major label, and one album doesn't go right, and you hate three people over there, and you go to war with, and you just fucking end your career.
Dude, I brought this up with Be Real, how I watched this Hulu documentary about Tekashi 6ix9ine,
mm-hmm.
and like that's a prime example of where like he and it wasn't even with the label or anything. It was just like he's got five like hits on the Billboard 100 all at the same time. He's got money coming in, but he just decides to switch his loyalty from like one crew to another crew, and they're like watching all this money come in, and he's like, ah, like that's asking for trouble.
And somehow he's still doing good, you know. He's
he's actually probably killing it right now.
I mean, he really is.
I don't know, man. I don't have an opinion either way, you know. Like it's not my place to have an opinion, but I was fascinated by that documentary, man. I thought it was fucking truly interesting.
Yeah, he played with fire.
Yeah, too. He did.
Yeah.
And I think that he's still like probably playing with it. But back to the NWA tour, mm-hmm. like Eazy-E reaches out to you. Did you ever lay down a track with Eazy-E?
Rappers didn't make songs together back then. Different crews didn't. You didn't mix the crew. Like your crew had your DJs.
Uh-huh.
Your crew had your rappers, you had your beat makers, and that's, you guys did that for your camp.
And then Run DMC changed the shit by doing the Walk This Way with Aerosmith.
Yeah, but that was also a collab that was
different.
It was
Rick Rubin, right?
It was in Rick Rubin's mind, and he always wanted to infuse rock and roll, heavy metal, sounding rock with rap, and he did it, and it was big, and he knew he was right what he was hearing, but it's still what they were doing back then. If you weren't under Russell Rush management or assigned to Def Jam, you weren't really getting the Rick Rubin, Russell Simmons influence.
Yeah, and it's probably a pretty big deal too, just the fact that Eazy-E reaches out to you to bring you on tour. Like, that's probably another thing that, you know,
he just knew that he was looking at the numbers. He knew how popular I was in the cities that we were going to, and he's like, you know, we had to, at one point before I dropped, the album I toured on was Life Is Too Short. Uh-huh. And they were touring on Straight Outta Compton. Right before that, he had Boys in the Hood, the song out, which was
like, he had Eazy Does It,
It was like a super giant record of like summer, like 87, 88, like the songs that just don't go away. I had Freaky Tales out. Those two records, Freaky Tales and Boys in the Hood, were like, they're like the best two records you could listen to in your car if you had woofers. And I mean, we just had that neck and neck thing we were doing where we did smaller shows together, and he saw the reaction to the crowd, and he just was like, I guess he had the opportunity to headline a tour, and he's like, I'm gonna take this guy to show with me. We didn't really know each other. We just knew each other from backstage and what's up, and you know.
And what was your label at that time? You said Jive Records?
I was on Dangerous Music, but I just signed a job. I own Dangerous Music, but I just signed a job.
So what's the motivation for that? Like, if you own the label that you're on, like, what can Jive can offer you?
Distribution.
Distribution,
worldwide distribution. We were limited to, we were making a lot of money, but we were limited to how fast we could manufacture the product.
Oh, wow.
And then get it to the streets, and then keep it in stores. We kept selling out. We could never manufacture enough.
Dude, that's a good problem to have. And when you do negotiate that deal with Jive, presumably because you've got your own label and you're in pretty good shape owning your own shit, that gives you leverage to negotiate a better deal with Jive.
To a certain extent. The labels are masters of, you know, just pimping.
Exactly. So, because it's Catch-22.
No matter how tough you get, you still turn around 5 years later and go, this fucking shitty-ass deal.
Right. Especially because, like, you know, we're talking about a time when it was impossible to really break out as a mainstream star with global success without a record deal. But it was impossible to really make money without owning your own music. So it's like chicken and the egg. And the
label's like, you know, you don't think of it when you're 20, 21 years old, but like logically, like why does it take 50 pages of a artist contract and 50 pages of a publishing contract to make a deal with you? What does 50 fucking pages do? Mm-hmm. And I mean, literally in these contracts, literally, you could have the best deal from page 1 to 12, and fucking page 36 in one paragraph says everything we agreed to on 1 through 12, it ain't true.
Right.
And they're like, well, you should have told him to take out this paragraph. I knew. It just says where to, where for, where as in one sentence.
Right.
It's like you need a lawyer to look over the contract, to sign your own lawyer.
Exactly. So
I don't know about that, but did you have a
later in life? You really learn that I need a lawyer, and then I need a lawyer to lawyer on my lawyer.
Well, it's like if you sign a lawyer on, they're like, okay, cool, like just sign this contract with us. You're like, that's what I'm hiring you for.
Right.
Yeah, but, he wants a contract. Yeah, what the fuck?
So when you signed a Jive in like 89 or before?
It was 88.
88. Okay, and at that point, do you have a lawyer negotiating your deal with Jive?
We had lawyers and everything, but at the same time, we were at a point where we couldn't really, we didn't want to become that company that, like, we should have. Like, if you think about what it could have been, it could have been $100 million. We could have been that, but that's a lot of fucking work.
Sure.
And you know, I'm a music guy. I didn't want to get tied up with the being a manufacturer and a distributor.
What was the Jive deal? It was a seven album deal.
Yeah, probably seven albums the first
time.
That's a lot of albums.
That's a lot of albums. Well,
probably six because we came in with one.
Okay.
And then we gave him the second one really fast. So it wasn't really...
Yeah, right. Like I heard that you delivered all your albums before you even received the budget to make the albums.
Yeah, just turn the albums in. And, you know, we got through the contract pretty quick. And then we renegotiated for, like a really decent look. But
and how many albums on the renegotiation deal?
Probably another handful. I ended up at Jive with, like, 12, 13 albums, somewhere up in there.
Right.
But...
How many did you play out on Dangerous?
Before Jive?
Yeah.
We just did the one album, Born a Mac.
Okay, so you had 375 Girls.
And we became
girls.
A production company. We signed a lot of groups through Jive and a couple other labels.
Oh, so you did the whole, like, Interscope and Shady kind of...
Exactly, you kind of like the sub-label, whatever they call them.
Right.
So you got to put the shit in context, though, because I'm doing good. I'm regional, very strong West Coast. And,
right.
You know, little tentacles out beyond the West Coast, but... I'm making most of my money from San Diego to Seattle, and just it's West Coast, and it's the distribution people that I'm using out of the Bay. They can't really get it to New York or anywhere, unless they partner with another distribution. So we knew our limitations, and then you're looking at Jive Records, who approached us, and at the time, they had the hottest rapper, Kumo D. They just signed Boogie Down Productions, KRS-One. They just signed Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince, Will Smith. And they hadn't got Tribe Called Quest yet, but they had Houdini. Houdini was next to Run DMC.
You had me at KRS-One.
Yeah, but I'm saying they had Houdini. This is before KRS.
Yeah.
Houdini's huge. They're the group that comes on the show with Run DMC and everybody, and they steal the show. That's those guys. Mm. And they're on Jive. They have fucking Billy Ocean, Caribbean Queen.
Wow.
And it's like, they're doing big things. But they, to me, I'm looking at Kumo D, and I'm looking at Houdini. And I'm like, well, shit, that's big.
Right. And you're right. Like, they're going to give you all the promotion, they're gonna blow you up. It's kind of like me being stand-up comedy. Mm-hmm. Like I do comedy, and my last comedy special, I put it out on my own website. Did great with it, but that's like independently putting it out. Now, like, what's gonna be the effect on my future career if I put my next special out on Netflix? That's probably pretty similar. Right.
So yeah, man, it's just it was just a matter of distribution, and then. On the other end, the percentages in the deal don't allow you to get what you get when you're independent, but then that's a trade-off for traveling around the world and getting paid a lot of money to perform in arenas. And then I don't get this career, I don't think I get the career that I've had if I stay independent.
Right.
I get sort of like, you know who stayed independent as far as
Cash
I know?
Cash Money Millionaires?
They ended up with Universal Cash Money early on. They got
the
$5 million deal, and they got the $5 million, and it was
okay.
You know, it was Juvenile, Back That Ass Up, and all that. They went big. Now I'm talking about more like a guy like Sir Mix-a-Lot,
who
did really good in like real estate, and he did really good with his independent label, and he decided to be his own mogul up in Seattle without becoming what the rest of us did, which was, you know, trade in your independent hustle for...
How about Master P? Did he ever sign to a label?
I really feel like he went to Priority, which was, like, not a major, but he went to Priority and hooked up a deal where... He hooked up a deal where he could make a lot of money with major distribution, but with independent type of...
So he kind of split the
numbers.
Difference.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what a lot of people did that over at Priority.
Yeah.
And I think, Master P, he really was, I think the smartest thing he did was the Bout It, Bout It movie. And he did the movie the same way he did the independent distribution of the music. So these really cheesy-ass movies made a lot of profit. You know? So from there, you couldn't really hold him back anymore. And, you know, everybody makes their little chess move. that get you to the next level?
Sure. So people didn't collab on tracks together back in the day.
It really didn't, unless you were claiming to be the, you know, affiliated crews or something.
Right.
It just really, it was, I could hang around rappers all day and we would never say, hey, let's do a song together. It would never come up.
Right. Ever. That would be like, let's get in the hot tub together or something.
It's just like, what the hell for?
But boy, did you like end up doing tracks with a bunch of people, man. You made one with Tupac.
The reason why I started doing a lot of collaborations is because in 1996, I turned 30 years old. At that time, there was a myth that 30-year-old rappers were old as fuck.
Right.
And when I turned 30, I released my 10th album. And 10 albums was like, who's got 10 albums? Like out of rappers,
sure.
Like in 1996, nobody had 10 albums. So when I announced that I was 30 years old, I released my 10th album, and I'm stepping away from the rap game. I retire. They were like, oh shit. And then they checked the track record, and of those 10 albums, it was like 6 platinum and like 4 gold, some shit like that. Some crazy number. And then the rumor went out, too sure, I got 10 platinum albums. And it's like all good for PR. But the numbers, I always play on the numbers, being the accountant's child.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, the 30, the 10, nice round numbers. You know, I retire. And when I retired, I got all this free press. It's the most free press I ever got that was positive. And because, you know, negative press is free as fuck.
Yeah.
And that shit goes far. But no, this best free press I ever got that was, you know, in my favor. And it was like, Too Short retires, 10 platinum albums, blah, blah, blah. And it just went everywhere. I just held one little press conference, and I threw a retirement party at the Century Club in Beverly Hills and Century City, whatever. And it was just, my phone went crazy.
Yeah.
And people were like, well, if you're going to retire, let me get a verse. Let me get on my album. Do this, that. So I did a song with Jay-Z.
Yeah.
Prior to the retirement, I had worked with, you know, some key figures.
That's how Tupac.
Yeah, Tupac came and got on one of my albums. And I did some stuff with Tupac, with Aunt Banks, who's my guy. I did the song with Biggie.
Yeah.
The World Is Filled. So now I already got the Jay-Z thing happening. I did a song with Eric Sermon. Me and him did a duet called Buy You Some. And, you know, he was huge in New York. So these records come out, Buy You Some. I did a song with Lil' Kim, Call Me, on the Booty Call movie soundtrack. I do the Biggie song, The World Is Filled. And then I had the Jay-Z song, Real Niggas Do Real Things, whatever. So this is my little
retirement, you know, party. That's your
so I retire, and then because it's Biggie, Jay-Z, and LA, everybody start calling, saying, man, let me get a Too Short verse. So I really went on like a, from that point on, I just did like a million features. And, you know, it just turned into Kevin Bacon, 7 Degrees of Separation. You know, like,
yeah,
like, fuck,
you're
Too
the
Short.
Kevin Bacon of rap.
I rapped with everybody in it. And, you know, the East Coast, West Coast thing broke out. And I was so wedged into loyal friendship with everybody that was supposed to be enemies in the war that when they came to me and they said, pick a side. And I was like, it ain't my war. Like, I'm from Oakland.
That's great, man. Dude, what did DOC say about, like, when, you know, I brought up how Eminem and Snoop were going after each other. He says, hey, man, I'm Switzerland.
Yeah, good. Diplomatic, yeah.
Yeah, so do we have to cut this short? I don't mean to be rude, we pushed your thing back, and do you have a premiere at 6?
Oh, yeah.
I hate to be that guy, but I see a lot of people huddling around the car looking in, so I'm not sure if those are your people.
I'm Scott Randolph. I'm Point Lifestyle.
I'm Point Scott Randolph, man.
I mean, I hate to be the wet blanket,
dude,
but we
could absolutely fucking...
Is there a guy standing right out there?
There's like,
yeah, two guys just showed up.
Yeah, they're getting the mic from the surfing thing.
And yeah, I think we're getting
that. Oh, those are with you, because there's another dude looking in to see what...
We got the light. All right, man. Well, dude, what a pleasure, man.
Sorry to cut everybody off.
This has been going fantastic. We can edit around it. I gotta tell you, man, mm-hmm. I like have had my struggles with like not shutting the fuck up, with not with like talking over people, and I think that this one, went really well, dude.
Yeah, you know.
If Steve,
still fucked up a little, but not as much as usual.
if Steve brings back his rap career, would you ever sing a verse on one of his albums?
Depends on the song.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm making a song about. It's called "I Love My Girl," but.
That's right up Too Short's alley, right there.
I'm already on that. I did a song with one of those guys, the Lonely Island, the Lonely.
Yeah. Oh my god, Andy Samberg. I saw about that. But "I Love My Girl," but is except it's about that 1 week a month, man. She the fucking the demon shows up, man. I can't fuck with the demon.
I'm like, I love my girl, but I love my other girl too.
Yeah. Oh, well, hey, man, dude, it's been a pleasure, dude. Really, thank you so
good
much.
Shit, and, good shit.
Sorry I was late too, man. That was a bad look, and thank you for being cool about it.
Dope van.
Oh,
man,
hey,
by
man,
way.
What can we shout out for you?
Just make sure you let the world know about Mount Westmore. Mount Westmore is Too Short, E-40, Ice Cube, and Snoop Dogg. We just started a group. We just released.
We released
a single called Big Sub Woofer, and the album's coming out, and you think, okay, those guys got together and made an album. No, we actually got together and recorded 50 songs. And
Shit. We
put an album together, and it was really difficult to figure out which songs could make the first album.
Damn, so, that's a power group.
Mount Westmore, you said?
Yeah, I guarantee
Mount Westmore, Too Short, Ice Cube, E-40, and Snoop.
Yeah, look it up right now. It's everywhere.
Jeez, all right, dude. I'll say that in the intro to the podcast, so that's the first piece of info they get.
All right, man. All
hey,
right,
man.
Thanks, dude.
Yo, thank you, Too
Short. Yeah, dope fan. You see this fan, man?
Yeah,
that was really sick.
Yeah, dude, how sweet was that? Now, you know I love you guys who stick around to the very end, and I want to tell you something. I've been resistant to playing back the podcasts and studying them, even though I know that that's going to make me better at it. But now, I've stumbled on a new practice. Yeah, dude, we set the YouTube version of the podcast to premiere, and then when it premieres, I go in the live chat, which forces me to review the podcast so I can study it and get better, and it allows me to interact with you guys in real time because I'm seeing every single one of your comments and I'm responding to you guys. So yeah, dude, it's a lot of fun, man. Now it's a big deal. It's the premiere of the Wild Ride podcast on the YouTube version. So I'm excited about that. Fuck, man. Thanks, dudes.